Good morning and welcome to two lectures I'm going to be doing on contraflow in global media. The first lecture is largely theoretical in the sense that I'm going to set up the debate about what contraflow is, why is it significant. And in the second lecture, I'm going to look at two illustrative examples of contraflow in global media, one from the world of entertainment and one from the world of news and current affairs. But in the first lecture, which is today's lecture, I'm going to be focusing on the concept of contraflow. As you all know, the global media market, which is relatively a recent phenomena, say 20 years old, was largely created because of some macro changes at an international level, economic changes, political changes, and perhaps most importantly, technological changes, the growth of satellite operations around the world, cabling of undersea oceans, availability of online content. And that has transformed the global media market. This market still remains largely dominated by the United States for reasons I don't need to emphasize, given that US is the most important economy in the world, but also very important cultural producer in terms of creative industries. It has the most advanced creative industries in the world. So if we look at the this media bazaar, this media market, which is essentially a commercial media market, and in a commercial media market, advertising is absolutely central. And if you look at this chart, this diagram rather, television remains the most important medium as far as advertising is concerned. Although internet has made massive expansion in the last decade particularly, but in terms of advertising revenue, television continues to dominate. Also important to remember is that much of this advertising revenue is concentrated in the United States. So for example, 33% of global advertising revenue across media channels comes from one country, namely the United States. So this has created a lot of discomfort and discussion about the domination of US media and what are its implications, both socially, culturally, economically too. In fact, in 1990s, late 1990s, when this became a big issue, UNESCO, United Nations organization directly involved in cultural communication, set up a World Culture Commission. And they produced a report, which I am going to quote from. They were particularly concerned about television. This is what this report said. The globalization of mainly US model of television has tended to increase Western cultural influence. Remember, this has gone across the globe because, as I said at the beginning, US has the capacity to both hardware and software. However, it said other models do exist based on different cultural, institutional, and historical backgrounds. Such alternatives are likely to multiply in the era of globalization, in spite of appearances which may paradoxically witness greater diversity than uniformity. So this is World Culture Report published by UNESCO in 1998. So even then, when globalization was largely a Western phenomena, especially the cultural globalization was largely an extension of US products around the world. Even then, UNESCO was suggesting that actually this is creating a more diverse media world, not a homogenized media world. And these commissions that UNESCO sets up, they comprise of people from different parts of the world, you know, artists, intellectuals, academics, government officials. So it's a pretty decent document, very international document. 10 years later, UNESCO set up another commission, which produced another global culture report. And I'm going to quote from that report. The report was published in 2009, and I'm just going to quote this passage from it, which actually indicates the phenomena I'm going to discuss in this lecture. While it is undeniable that globalization has played an integrative role as a window on the world, mostly to the profit of a few powerful international conglomerates, recent shifts prompted by technological innovation, largely digitization, and new consumption patterns are spurring new forms of globalization from below and creating a two-way flow of communication and cultural products. So the flow is still dominated by the West, largely US originated content, but there is also a small but significant reverse flow, a contra flow. Although how contra is contra, that's a question for discussion. It's not as straightforward. But the fact that there is a diverse content emerging not just from, you know, from New York or Hollywood, but also from Mumbai, from Shanghai, from Egypt, from Turkey, from South Africa, from Brazil, etc., which makes it a much more interesting global media place. Now, I have been particularly involved in this kind of discourse. About 10 years ago, I edited a book. It was called Media on the Move. Global Flow and Contraflow was the subtitle of that book. And it was, to my mind, the first kind of study looking at the rise of the non-Western media. And it's a collection of essays from people, you know, covering different aspects from news to internet, to telenovelas, to cinema. Korean wave is supposed to be very important in East Asia, for example, Korean cultural wave. And in that book, I devised a typology of media flows. And I divided it into two categories, the dominant global flows and the usual suspects appear, you know, and with the exception of two in this list, which is BBC and Japanese animation, rest are US-based corporation. Again, understandably so. But both the BBC, which has been a global player for a very long time and continues to be a very important player, especially in terms of news and current affairs, but also historical dramas, documentaries, sport coverage. They're not so much sports now, but you know, generally seen as a credible global presence. And the Japanese animation has been around for a very long time, going back to 1970s. A whole generation of American kids have grown up without realizing they have consumed essentially a Japanese product. So these are dominant media flows, and they continue to be dominant. And given the structure of these corporations and where they are based and the connection they have with the governments in these very powerful nations, I don't think that is going to change anytime soon. So the dominant flow remains largely Western, largely in English language. But there's also a what I call a subaltern media flow emerging from the margins of global media place. And I divided it into two categories, transnational and geocultural. Now, transnational is kind of product which is available in various countries, not necessarily confined to a particular geopolitical or geocultural or geolinguistic group. So I have Bollywood and inverted commas, because Bollywood, as you know, is a contested term. Al Jazeera, the Pan-Arabic News Network. I will discuss both of these as case studies in my next lecture, because they are arguably the most prominent non-Western entertainment and news networks. But also telenovelas, for instance, from Mexico and Brazil are shown in more than 130 countries. The TV Globo network in Brazil is extremely influential, not just in the Lusophone world, not just the Portuguese-speaking world, but beyond that. TV5 is the French language international channel. And again, Francophonie is a huge constituency where French is spoken in Africa, in parts of Northern America, etc. Telesur is a pan-Latin American network, a news network. It was created in Venezuela with Venezuelan oil money, but now it's not in the same position because the economy is in a mess. Radio France International, CCTV News, Chinese network, RT, Russia Today, as it was called, again, an international network. Euronews is the kind of alliance of public service news broadcasters in Western Europe and is viewed across Western Europe. Mnet is the largest entertainment network coming out of South Africa and has presence across the continent. Korean films I mentioned specifically because Korean films have become extremely important as an export commodity, especially in East Asia, in China, in Japan, in Taiwan, they are very popular. And Nollywood, the Nigerian film industry, is the third largest in the world in terms of the number of films they produce. Although in terms of quality, they are not as good for various reasons, including resources, technology, etc. And they're often shown direct to DVD. They are not actually screened in cinemas. And then you have the other, and this is not an exhaustive list. This is an indicative list. Then you have the, what I call the geocultural networks, which are basically aiming at a specific geolinguistic group. Again, it's an indicative list. Phoenix, for instance, is a Chinese network. It's the largest Chinese network, catering to the Chinese diaspora. And Chinese diaspora is the largest in the world, 35 million. ZTV, you all know, the largest conglomerate in India, has been operating now in, 170 countries, thereabouts. TRT, International Turkish Radio and Television, again, has emerged as an important player, certainly in Central Asia, where they have close links, traditional links, also linguistic, cultural, with Turkey. Al-Hayat, the most significant pan-Arabic newspaper with editions in different parts of the world. Baidu, famous Chinese online portal. MBC is the largest entertainment network in the Middle East, Arabic world. NHK World, the Japanese network, Islam Online, again a kind of religious space for the Ummah, for the people who belong to Islam, but they have a connectivity with this group, not necessarily national but transnational, and Rose TV, which is the network of the world's largest stateless minority, namely the Kurds. They are scattered all over the world. They don't have a nation state, but they have a television network which they kind of communicate with each other. So again, these are some prominent examples of emerging media content, both in terms of commercial. Some of these are commercial operations like ZTV, Globo, for instance, Nollywood is commercial. Some are state-led projects. So CCTV News, the Chinese news network, is a state project. RT is a state project. So it's a combination of both state-sponsored networks as well as commercial networks. And this has created an interesting discussion about what does it mean to culture? Yeah, what happens when you're watching, in China, you're watching Korean drama, or in Africa, you are watching ZTV. You have no connection with India, but you're watching a very Indian soap opera. And also, of course, in the more developed part of the world, in the so-called first world, what does it do, this kind of contraflow? So a few reflections on that, how it makes the global-local interaction more complicated. I'm going to use some quotations to basically make my points about this interaction. First quotation is from John Tomlinson, who is a British academic who wrote a very well-known book on cultural imperialism, where he critiqued the idea of cultural imperialism. And one of his arguments was, as is indicated in this quotation, that actually the culture of the dominant parts of the world is also being affected by globalization. Here, the effects of globalization are to weaken cultural coherence in all individual nation states, including the economically powerful ones, the imperial powers of a previous era. So here he is referring obviously to the United Kingdom, where, as you probably know, the most popular dish is chicken tikka, you know, which is a made-up dish anyway. So it's a reflection of that kind of impact on the UK culture from India, for instance. Others have argued that this kind of globalization, which is an a-territorial globalization, is creating deterritorialized space and re-territorialization, in the sense that so-called third world cultures are coming to cosmopolitan areas of the world and creating a complex, hybridized kind of interaction. Others have talked about the idea of glocalization, and Ronald Robertson, British sociologist, is the person with whom this concept is particularly associated. He coined the phrase glocalization. The tailoring and advertising of goods and services on a global or near global basis to increasingly differentiated local and particular markets. So if you look at content from major media networks around the world, the local element is very prominent. So if you watch MTV in India, it is a Bollywoodized version of MTV. A lot of content you see is actually produced in India, in an Indian kind of sensibility. And there are numerous other examples. And there's a big debate about hybridization, that there is no pure cultures. Cultures have always given and taken from different cultures, and there is a kind of hybrid culture. Some have argued that hybridization is a new form of hegemony, because the question is, who is hybridizing with whom? So we see a lot of Western content coming into non-Western world. You see it on Korean television, in Chinese dramas, in Indian television, in Turkish television. But there isn't the same amount of hybridization happening in American television or German television or British television. So who is hybridizing with whom, with what result, is an interesting question. So having set this kind of framework, I'm going to just in my next lecture talk about two examples. One is the example from the world of entertainment. As you see on this slide, I picked a few examples from Turkey. The top Turkish soap operas are extremely popular, by the way, across the Middle East, and even in India I've seen them on Zindagi network. Dubbed in Hindi, of course. They're popular in Pakistan, Afghanistan, Iran, Middle East, most Arab countries, and in Greece and Bulgaria, and so it's an interesting phenomenon in itself. The Nigerian film I mentioned here is one of the most successful ones, and again, Nigeria has a huge diaspora. It's the largest populated country in Africa. The South Korean one at the bottom is the again, a popular example of both films and television, as well as popular music. coming out of South Korea and then circulating not just in Asia but beyond. And of course, China is investing a huge amount of money in its entertainment. And some estimates say by 2018, which is not very far, Chinese box office will be bigger than American box office. That changes things around. If that is to happen, which is likely, you might be surprised to see, not surprised in fact, you should be expecting it, a mainstream Hollywood film with a Chinese hero or Chinese heroine. But my focus really is going to be on Bollywood, which is the world's largest film factory in terms of number of films it produces, and that's going to be discussed in my next lecture. In terms of, in terms of news, there is again a very complicated scenario today. The traditional dominant players, namely CNN and BBC, are still there, are still very important, but there is a lot more out there. And these are some examples. And from Africa 24 to Press TV, which is the Iranian English language channel, NHK World, the Japanese one, Telesur, I mentioned earlier, NDTV, of course, you know, CCTV News, Deutsche Welle in English, RT, and TRT World is the latest one, which is a Turkish radio and television world, is an English language channel they have launched a few weeks ago, largely to provide a different perspective on their recent coup. They felt that they had a coup, and the world heard about that coup largely from Western sources, and they felt that they have to have their voice, and they put together an English language news channel with operations around the world. So, but I'm going to be focused on one in the center here, which is Al Jazeera, as the most significant non-Western news network to have emerged in the last decade or so, which actually hasn't made an impact on international news. So let me just, so that's it. I'm going to finish with that, but the next lecture is going to be looking in more detail, both entertainment and news, with illustrative examples to contextualize the whole idea of Contraflow. I'll stop there. Thank you.